Hello everyone and assalamu alaikum. This is Introduction to Psychology part 2 by Dear Knowledge. Okay, so we have started the chapter 2 and it's all about emotions. I've already told you that chapter 2 is going to be a bit detailed and longer, so that's why I divided the chapter into different parts, so it will be easy for you people to understand the chapter 2 very easily. So in order to give you a quick recap, in the part 1 of the chapter 2, we learn about defining emotion and components of emotions. And in defining emotion, we learn about the definitions that were given by the different well-known personalities in the field of psychology and how did they define emotion, and then we came up with a conclusion. And after that, in the part 1, we learn about the components of emotion, in which we have learned about the different components of emotion, including behavioral components, psychological components, physiological components. So there were different components of emotion which we have learned in the part 1 of the chapter 2. Then come to the part 2, which is about which was about the characteristics of emotions. In the part 2, we learned we have studied the characteristics of emotion in great detail. There were different characteristics of emotions. Then in part 3, we learned about the functions of emotions, and we learned that about the advantages of emotions, the importance of emotions. So part 3, in the functions of emotions, we have covered all these topics. Then come to the part 4, which was about the arousal of emotion. We learn about what kind of physiological changes occurs during the arousal of emotions and what kind of physiological changes leads to the arousal of emotions. So it was quite interesting when I was making the part 4, the arousal of emotion. I really enjoyed it. So all the links are given in the description section. If you have missed any of the previous lectures, the links are present in the description section. Go ahead, click on those links and watch those videos. If any of the link is missing, you can ask me in the comment section and I'm going to be there to help you out by updating the description section for your people. So in this video, we will be learning about the physiological correlates of emotions. So this is going to be the part 5. Of the chapter 2, and it's all about the physiological correlates of emotions. Okay, so let's start with the physiological correlates of emotions. So in order to understand something about interactions between physiology and emotional experience, we need to begin by looking at the physiological mechanisms which are involved. And much of our experience of stress and of negative emotions is influenced by the action of autonomic nervous system and what we refer to very generally as arousal. Okay, the autonomic nervous system, I have also uploaded a separate video on this, a great detailed video on the autonomic nervous system. A separate playlist on the nervous system is also present in the playlist section of this video. You can watch those videos in order to enhance your knowledge. In this video, we will study about the nervous system, and we will study, we will learn that how the physiological changes, the physiological correlates of emotion occurs in the nervous system of the human body. So, the autonomic nervous system is a general name given to a network of unmyelinated nerve fibers which run from the spinal cord and the lower regions of the brain to the internal and sensory organ of the body. And activation of the sympathetic division of the nervous system, of the autonomic nervous system, is often given the general term of arousal. And the reason for this is that it produces a number of different physiological changes in the body, and each of which contributes to making the individual more alert and active. So fibers of the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system pass from the medulla and spinal cord to the visceral internal organs of the body, and their mode of operating when they are activated in this way. So each of these changes contributes to the state of alertness and preparedness for action, which we loosely call arousal. And if we are preparing to be highly active, We need to ensure that muscles are strong and well supplied with blood, sugar, and oxygen necessary for action. And so the spleen releases more red blood cells so that the blood can carry more oxygen. The heart begins to beat faster, circulating blood more rapidly around the body and replenishing the oxygen supply more rapidly. And breathing becomes deeper, taking more oxygen into the lungs. And at the same time, the digestive system also changes its mode of operation so that the sugar is abolished much more quickly to provide an instant energy supply. But food which requires longer-term digestion, like protein and fats, take longer. So the physiological changes involved in arousal are stimulated by the neural impulse from the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system, but they're maintained by the action of the endocrine system. So this is a series of glands which release hormones into the bloodstream, thereby helping to maintain consistent state within the body. So the hormones which are connected or which are concerned with stress and arousal are released from the pituitary and adrenal glands following stimulating from the sympathetic nerve fibers of the autonomic nervous system. So we have included the autonomic nervous system in this chapter, the physiological correlates of the emotion. Now let's talk about the central nervous system of the nervous system, and let's discuss what kind of physiological changes or what kind of physiological correlates of emotion occurs in the central nervous system. So let's start with the cerebral cortex. Cerebral cortex is basically divided into hemisphere and is responsible for sophisticated mental functions. So the cortex of the brain appears to play an important role in the control of emotional behavior. Experimental animals whose cortex are removed, so-called decorticate, and the experiment was done on dogs and cats, they showed emotional reactions, particularly rage and anger, even when the mildest stimuli was presented. Now let's come to the hypothalamus. We will start with a short experiment. So experiments have indicated that activity of the hypothalamus regulates expression of emotion by face and body posture. So impulses that come from the hypothalamus increase both smooth muscle, which is involuntary, and skeletal muscle, which is voluntary. So the impulses that comes from the hypothalamus increases both involuntary and voluntary activity. So impulses from the hypothalamus also determine the types of emotion experienced. If impulses are from the posterior sympathetic division, the emotion felt is excitement. If the impulses are from the anterior parasympathetic division, the individual feels relaxed. Now, the emotion felt by the individual is determined by the stimuli and the bodily responses they produced. Damage to the hypothalamus, as in case of surgical lesions, dramatically affects the patterns and incidence of such emotions as rage. Now, in the experimental laboratory, cats that were tame and friendly became hostile following surgery to produce lesions in the hypothalamus. So this type of induced rage is referred to as shame rage, and it is used by the psychologist to study the physiological changes that take place in enraged organism. So this was about today's video. If your concept is clear, you can like the video. If there was any point that was creating a bit confusion, you didn't get that point, you can ask me in the comment section and we will be happy to help you out. Plus, if you're new to this channel, subscribe to our channel, subscribe to Dear Knowledge, click on the bell icon so you will never ever miss any notification. And you can share the link of this video, link of our channel, with your family members and friends, because sharing is caring. Until then, Allah Hafiz.